It is very clear that I had ptosis at birth. I did not have surgery until I was around 4 or 5. What is the cost of this? I checked into having the surgery done a few years ago, but since it did not interfere with my vision, it was considered cosmetic, so insurance would not cover it. I would like to have the surgery done. I feel it is only going to droop even more as I get older. It is not a neurological problem. I wonder what the cost is for this surgery and how complicated it is. In addition, is it too late for me to have this surgery done? I was teased as a child quite a lot.
Thank you for your question. You've submitted some photos and you mentioned in your question that you have congenital ptosis. You did have surgery when you were around 4 or 5 years of age, and that apparently you had some difficulty with insurance coverage several years ago because it wasn't blocking your vision enough. So you've asked several times about the cost of the surgery. So I want to explain to you a little bit about the challenges that are unique to someone who is a little bit older who has congenital ptosis. And I'll share with you how we approach and evaluate a patient and then make recommendations. This will also help give you an understanding of what the costs would be, even though you still need to have an examination before you can determine this. And I'll give you my opinion on insurance companies and coverage of this type of stuff. First of all, congenital ptosis means that the muscle that lifts the eyelid, called the levator muscle, like the word elevator, did not develop fully during gestation. And it tends to run in families, but sporadically. And so it's not like, except for a certain exceptional family patterns, most of the time it just tends to express differently. So several siblings can be born and only one may have ptosis. Anyway, the point is that this muscle can either have mildly affected in terms of the level, to severely affected in terms of the level, and the actual activity of the muscle can be everything from fully functional to very weak. So when we do a ptosis examination, we look at a patient and see what their eyelid level is, see how much it blocks their pupil, and then we ask them to look down and up to establish how much muscle function they have. From an ophthalmologic point of view, from the point of view of eye health, we also want to look at conditions such as dry eye, and as well as something called a Bell's phenomenon, where the eyeball is a protective mechanism to make sure that the eye rolls up a little bit so that when you're sleeping, even if your eyes open a little bit, that they're still protected. All of these are very important factors. So in choosing the type of surgery, we'll basically divide it into those with good enough muscle function versus those who have virtually no muscle function. With those with good enough muscle function, we'll typically do something called a levator muscle resection. And that means shortening this muscle so that the eyelid can come up. Now, when you shorten that muscle, that means that the eyelid will open, but it will not relax or close the exact same way as the other eye. And in addition, you have to be prepared to always add lubrication to the eyes as part of your post-operative care for long term. One of the things that especially people who are older have to understand is that almost everyone who is beyond the age of 40 has some degree of dry eye. And the older you get, the drier your eyes get. So when your eye is drooping, it's actually covering more of your eye, and you're actually not as exposed. When the eye is open, the eye is more exposed. So you're going to have to use some type of strategy to make sure the eye is properly lubricated. Something I didn't mention that Even if you have congenital ptosis, and a common speech I have for patients who have congenital ptosis is that it is not surprising for a patient with ptosis to have more than 3 operations in their lifetime. One in childhood for visual development, one in adolescence to early adulthood for aesthetics, and then one later in life because as the tissue stretches and the facial aging process goes on, you'll need it for more functional and aesthetic reasons. Now, another type of ptosis affects people who don't have congenital ptosis, and this is called levator muscle dehiscence or aponeurotic ptosis. This is a normal age-related attenuation or thinning of the muscle that causes the eyelid to droop. So you may be dealing with that in the other eye, and so an examination has to establish whether or not there's any merit to addressing the other eye at the same time. There's something called Herring's Law, where we actually lift the more droopy eyelid, and very often the other side, the other eyelid actually will descend. It has to do with the amount of signal that's being generated by the brain to push the eyelids open, but it's something that is a part of an examination to determine the optimal procedure. Now, the other option besides a levator resection is a procedure called a frontalis sling. It is done routinely on younger children, but when it's done for an adult, there is a challenge here. When a child has a procedure like this, their eyes will be open all the time, particularly when they're sleeping. But because they're young and they produce a lot of tears and they have a functioning Bell's phenomena and there is some stretch with time, they don't end up with dry eye symptoms. You do this procedure on an adult, you have one eye that's actually always open, and to summarize, it's basically a procedure where the forehead muscle called the frontalis muscle is connected with the eyelid so that when you raise your eyebrows, which you do now reflexively, you're actually able to push the eyelid more effectively open because you're using the muscle activity of the frontalis muscle to lift the eyelid. That's one eye that actually has to be forced to blink while the other eye blinks normally. And it takes a long time for an adult to acclimate to this. It's kind of like teaching your body and brain to create new habits. There have been times when I've done this procedure where I actually had to go back and release the eyelid in order to protect the eye more, even though the aesthetic result was so nice because of tearing and eye irritation. So that means that you really need a really thorough examination and evaluation. In terms of the cost of this procedure, you're going to have to see if your doctor that you choose accepts insurance and is willing to go through the process of insurance approval. The problem in the modern world and why over 10 years ago I stopped accepting any kind of medical insurance is that insurance companies are openly deceptive in their practices. They will approve a procedure and then later on deny the procedure. Or they'll go back and audit doctors and say that their procedures were not indicated and ask for refunds. And I never lived through any of that, but I saw how very deserving patients whose eyes were completely closed were being denied care by insurance companies. And basically, as much as they play the game of working around legal contracts, they're essentially practicing medicine as far as I'm concerned. So I have nothing but contempt for insurance companies. So as far as that financial hurdle is concerned, you're going to have to try and find a doctor that either accepts insurance and is willing to go through that with you, or find a doctor who you can afford. But you know, cost is a factor, and the procedure does require, in our practice, for example, a surgeon's fee, anesthesia, and facility costs, which are part of delivering high quality care. You never want to do shortcuts or go cheap when in such a type of procedure. So that being said, you need to meet with doctors, and most likely you'll meet with oculofacial or oculoplastic surgeons who have extensive experience in this area. Most general plastic surgeons aren't trained in this area and don't really practice this, so you'll not likely find too many that are willing to do this type of surgery. But meet with doctors and see who you're comfortable with and figure out what option you are comfortable with. And moving forward, I wish you the best of luck. I hope that was helpful. And thank you for your question.